us pray. Dear God, we thank you for this worship experience. Thank you for your son, Jesus. He came that we might have a light, right to the tree of life. Thank you for deliverance, salvation.
Thank you, God.
Thank you for the peace that passes all of understanding. Bless this word now, God, as we go forth. Thank you for those who are here in the sanctuary, those who may be listening through social media. Bless us now. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Please, as you stand on your feet, go with me to John 3:16. Jesus as the divine teacher. We must remember that when Jesus came to this earth, he came to teach men how to flee darkness, and he came to be the light. He came to teach us how to flee death and how to enter into life. In this chapter of John, we find Jesus carrying out this ministry as a teacher. Here he gets the opportunity to teach a teacher named Nicodemus. And Jesus does just that. Can I get a witness? However, Jesus also uses this passage to instruct us also. As we take the time to look at our text this morning, there may be some among us who are in the same shape Nicodemus was. He was a man who was at the pinnacle of success. He had it all. He was a respected man. He had power. He had money. He had position. And all the things that are considered the manifestations of a successful life. Yet he lacked that one thing that could guarantee him a life eternal experience. Yet he lacked salvation. He lacked a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. This great lack in the life of Nicodemus becomes the topic of Jesus as he holds class with Nicodemus. He had a one-on-one class. You might say one-on-one class. Sometimes Jesus has a one-on-one class with us. Can I get a word? Rings that bell, and we go into the school classroom, amen, sometime late in the midnight hour. He rings the bell and wakes us up because he wants to have class with us. So for the next few minutes, let's join Jesus, the divine teacher, in his classroom. As we do, I ask that you allow the Lord to speak to your heart and then do what he calls you to do. If you have never trusted Jesus as your personal Savior, you will at least hear how to do just that today. Amen. Nobody ever explained the truth like Jesus. Can I get a witness? Let's listen in as he teaches. And Zion, for over 3 years now, I have been trying to tell you how much God loves you. But I cannot do it with just my poor stammering tongue. So if I can borrow Jacob's ladder and climb up to heaven and ask Gabriel, who stands in the presence of God, to tell me how much God loves sinners, of all he could say would be, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And if you have known and believed this verse, like me since childhood, prepare that God will bring the wonder of his amazing love to you in such a way that you would renew your first love for the Lord Jesus. Look at somebody and say, love is the message. Biblically, there are three centers of God's love. John 3:16 tells us that God so loved the world. Ephesians 5:25 says Christ also loved the church. Galatians 2:20 says, the Son of God who loved me. Aren't you glad that you can have a personal love affair with the lover of your soul? Amen? I just want to know what love is. Jesus told Nicodemus that the key to receiving salvation is as simple as believing. Somebody say, believing. Religion tries to make it difficult for men to be made right with God. There are always rules to follow and steps to complete. Then just when you think you have arrived, you always find that you have omitted some step or the other. Religion makes it almost impossible for men to be saved. Jesus, on the other hand, makes it so simple that little children, that older children, that people with limited intelligence, people who can't add or subtract, or even write their own name, can be saved by the grace of God. Can I get a witness? How much simple could God have made it? He has already done all the work. He has already paid all the prices. He has torn down all the barriers. All he asks is that sinners to do is for us to come to him and believe him. Isaiah said it this way in Isaiah 45:22, look unto me and be saved. He that believeth on me has everlasting life. Jesus said it this way in John 6:47. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me has everlasting life. Paul said it this way in Acts 16:31. When someone asked him, what must I do to be saved? He said, believe on the Lord Jesus, and you shall be saved, you and your house. And after 2,000 years, nothing has changed. Sinners are still saved by simply believing in Jesus and coming to him by faith. For God so loved the Jews would not have been shocking to a Jew. The Jews knew that they were God's chosen people and that he had set his special love on them. So there was nothing new or shocking to the Jews about the fact that God loved the Jews. And for God so loved sinful Jews, that might have been a bit more of a stretch, but if a religious Jew thought about it, he might concede the point. Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness so that the sinning Jew who had been bitten by the fiery serpents could look to it and live. So even though the self-righteous Pharisees thought that they were above common sinners, they might have agreed that God loved even sinful Jews. But God so loved the world. That was just plain shocking to Nicodemus. By world, Jewish leaders would have immediately thought Gentiles. Also, John often uses the word to refer to sinful people who were hostile toward Christ and eventually crucified him. John wants us to understand that God's love goes beyond the Jews to the Gentiles, from every tribe and tongue and people and nation. And his love extends even to those who are his committed enemies. Love your enemies. It is a whosoever policy. When the Lord made his plan of salvation, he determined to exclude no one. God has flung wide the doors of grace and beckons all who will come to him and be saved from their sins and from an eternity in hell. And if you need salvation today, then today is the day. Today is the day to come to Jesus and receive him. Salvation is a whosoever deal. And I'm glad about that. Because I didn't always qualify to be called righteous. Can I get a witness? I wasn't always on the good foot. And if some church folks would have had their way, amen, a lot of us wouldn't be here today. Because there's a lot of people that forgot, amen, what they used to be before God saved their soul. Can I get a witness? But whosoever is the policy. Because it's not God loves the Jew or God loves the sinful Jew. It's that God so loved the world. Amen. It is the love of God which was manifested toward us that God has sent his only begotten Son into us, into our world, so that we might live through him. It is this love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. Can I get a witness? You can't say you love God who you've never seen, and don't love your brother or your sister who you see every day. So love is indeed the message. Because Jesus Christ himself said, how the world going to know that you're my disciples? It ain't by the car you drove up here in. It ain't by the number of zeros you have behind your bank account. Come on, somebody. It ain't about the number of dollars you have on your food stamp card. Can I get a witness? But it's shown by the love that you have for one another. So you call yourself a child of God and you celebrating Jesus, amen, but you ain't got no love for nobody but yourself. You have deceived yourself. Can I get a witness? Because it's better to give and as I close with all of the material gifts that the world has turned Christmas into. I don't know about you, but I'd rather have Jesus than silver and gold. Thank you for the tie, amen. Thank you for the little bit of money. Come on, can I get a witness? Thank you for the Christmas cake, amen. And the Thanksgiving Day pig's feet. But I'd rather have Jesus. Come on, thank you for the watch, amen. Thank you for the cologne, can I get a witness? Thank you for the socks that I probably won't wear. Help me, Holy Ghost. But I'd rather have Jesus. Come on, can I get a witness? Thank you for the telegram. Thank you for the telephone call. Thank you for the Merry Christmas. But I'd rather have Jesus than silver and gold. The phone rang the other day, and I answered it. Come on, y'all, leave that alone. After several seconds of silence, a voice on the other end of the line spoke and said, please hold for an important message. Well, I did just what most of you do when you get one of those wonderful calls from a telemarketer. I hung up. If it was Brother Bailey, I wouldn't hang up. If it was Brother Jones, I wouldn't hang up. But come on, brother. I have an important message for you. Now, of course, I didn't find out what that important information was. I'm sure that there was a message for me concerning the life-altering benefits of vinyl replacement windows. Or maybe there was life-changing details regarding seamless gutters. Or maybe they were going to try to sell me a timeshare that I can't afford to get to each year. Oh, well, I guess I will never know. It seems that everyone has something to say to us today. It seems that everyone has a message for us. Everyone wants us to lend them our ears while they fill us in on what they think, what they want, what they're doing. The news media wants your ear. Politicians want your ear. Advertisers want your ear. Telemarketers want your ear. Commercials want your ear. Most of these are words, opinions, and details we don't really want to hear. Can I get a witness? However, there is one person who wants to tell you something that you really should take the time to listen to. In this passage, the Lord brings us an important message from God the Father. He tells us something that we really need to listen to this morning. You can hang up, amen, if you want to. But I would advise you to stay on the line for a little while this morning. The Lord has something to say to you, so please hold for an important message. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. This is the thought that I want to leave you with for a while. God so loved the world. God, who is the greatest love, so loved who in which is the greatest degree. The world, which is the greatest company. His one and only Son, amen, which is the greatest gift. All you have to do is believe on him and you shall be saved. God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that through the world, through him, might be saved. So fear not to take unto thee Mary, thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. And I'm here to tell somebody that that which is conceived in you is of the Holy Ghost. Can I get a witness? We need more pregnant people in the church now. Somebody who is pregnant with something from God. Can I get a witness? I may be a man, but I'm here to tell somebody that I'm pregnant. Help me, Holy Ghost. Is there anybody here that's pregnant with something? I'm pregnant with a promise from God. Can I get a witness that everything I went through in 2018, God is going to deliver and make it make sense in 2019? I don't know about you, but I'm claiming today that 2019 will be my year. Can I get a witness? I've been through labor and delivery all through 2018. I walked myself into the first trimester of swollen ankles, can I get a witness, and craving pickles and peanut butter. I praised my way into the second trimester, can I get a witness, but I went through and the devil tried to take me out, but I found out that no weapon ever formed against me shall prosper. I made my way into the third trimester, and I began to feel the baby kick and push. Can I get a witness? He pushed with me, prayed until something happened. And I made my way into the labor and delivery room. And I became fully dilated. And I'm going to deliver my promise in 2019. I wish I had somebody who was pregnant also, who's been through labor and delivery. It don't feel good, do it. The devil tried to cause pain in your life. The devil tried to cause contractions in your life. But whenever you get a in contraction, whenever you feel pain, just push, baby. Pray until something happens, because love. Is the message. I'm talking about Jesus. I'm talking about Jesus. The one who has more books written in his name than any library can contain. The one that Herod couldn't kill. The one that sin couldn't seduce. The one that death couldn't keep. The one that the grave couldn't hold. I'm talking about the one who got on heaven's elevator and said, Father, make me a body. He got on heaven's elevator, took it down 42 floors. He came through a lobby called Mary. Can I get a witness? He was bruised for my iniquity. He was wounded for my transgressions. And the peace of our chastisement is upon him. And with his stripes we're healed. Can I get a witness? They stretched the baby wide. They hung the baby high. He died for me. And he died for you. They put him in a borrowed tomb. But early Sunday morning, the baby got up. And because the baby lived, I can face tomorrow. But that ain't how the story is. Can I get a witness? Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because he lives, I can deliver. Can I get a witness? Deliver, deliver, deliver. Somebody need to deliver. He's the greatest gift of all. He's a bridge over troubled water. He's a shelter in the time of the storm. He's a mind regulator. He's a heart fixer. He is my burden bearer. Come on, somebody. He's a wheel in the middle of a wheel. He's a sweet rose of Sharon. Help me, Holy Ghost. And he's a lily in the valley. I got all I need. Can't nobody do me like Jesus. Can't nobody do me like the Lord. Without the gift. Don't leave Mount Zion without the gift. Don't walk out with a gift from Best Buy, but don't have the gift from the Most High. Can I get a witness? I got the gift, and every now and then, I can feel the gift kicking. I can feel the gift turning. I feel a little gift turning now, and like fire, bones. He walks with me and he tells me I'm his own and the joy.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. As we stand on our feet. Amen. As we stand on our feet. There might be one here today and don't know Jesus as a personal Savior. You don't want to close out if you are in the building that you don't know Jesus. This is your opportunity. This is the most important part of the service for someone that don't know him. We offer the invitation now. And if there be one, will you step forward and come now? This is why Jesus came. This is why Jesus died. So that we may have relationship with the Father. There is the part of the Christmas story that is not told. Is that he's coming back. He was born. He was crucified. But the part that we don't talk about because his service is he's coming back. And if he comes back at 5 o'clock today, will you be ready? Have you made your business right with the Lord? There is a reckoning day coming. The disciples stood and watched him as he went up in the clouds. But they told him that same Jesus that left, he's coming back. Amen. I guess everybody's soul is satisfied with the Lord. Let us now come to the altar so that we can close out in prayer. Amen. Come to